Buenas tardes a todos, los presentes en este auditorio y también a quienes nos siguen en línea a través de nuestras plataformas. Les doy la bienvenida al Centro de Estudios Públicos. Soy Mauricio Salgado, investigador del CEP, y hoy tengo el placer de presentarles al doctor Nate Bresnau, sociólogo e investigador del Centro de Investigación sobre Desigualdad y Política Social de la Universidad de Bremen, en Alemania. Los intereses de investigación del Dr. Bresnau se enfocan en tres ámbitos principales. En primer lugar, la ciencia abierta, es decir, concientizar en la importancia que tiene la transparencia, accesibilidad y replicabilidad de nuestros hallazgos. En segundo lugar, la metaciencia, es decir, el análisis científico del modo en que los científicos sociales investigan y hacen ciencia. Y en tercer lugar, un tercer foco de interés del Dr. Bresnau, es la relación entre opinión pública y política social, tema del que nos presentará hoy. En el nombre del Centro de Estudios Públicos y de su director Leonidas Montes, quiero agradecer al proyecto FONDESIT, liderado por el sociólogo Juan Carlos Castillo de la Universidad de Chile, quien nos acompaña el día de hoy, y al Centro de Estudios de Conflicto y Cohesión Social, el COES, por invitar a Chile al Dr. Bresnau y por permitirnos conversar con él hoy acá en el CEP. La presentación del Dr. Bresnau lleva por título Redistribución, Políticas de Bienestar y Opinión Pública. ¿Qué sabemos? Durante su charla, el Dr. Bresnau analizará la relación entre tres conceptos, estos tres conceptos, utilizando encuestas como la International Social Survey Program, la ISSP, de la cual de hecho, el CEP es parte también. El Dr. Bresnau presentará varias perspectivas sobre las preferencias públicas por la redistribución y por qué es importante estudiarlas. Luego de la presentación, haré un breve comentario con un par de preguntas y abriremos también las preguntas para el público presente. Quienes nos ven por streaming también pueden enviarnos sus preguntas al correo preguntas@cepchile.cl. Dr. Bresnau, the floor is yours.
So thank you very much to the CEP, especially, and the audience for being here and the nice introduction. So I will try to do two things in the talk, because we are a very, I think, diverse audience here, so not all just academics, so to speak. And so one of the first things is I would like to have a critical discussion or maybe raise some provocative points or things we should think about when it comes to redistribution
cuando hablamos de la redistribución y bienestar social y el rol de la opinión pública.
The second one is, though, I'm also an academic, so we will present some of the research that I'm doing with some of my colleagues in Bremen on this topic.
So, así que,
so one of the, we should sort of define our terms to begin with, and all governments in the world engage in some type of redistribution. And the way that this redistribution takes place is through taxes and spending, right? So taxes are a collection of money, and then spending is outlays for certain purposes. And these purposes can be things like public utilities, right? Roads or national defense or social welfare, for example. The redistribution of risks. So risks could mean related to working in the labor market, work injury or disability, or the risk of becoming unemployed, or just the risk of old age, right? So that you would be out of the labor market at some point and we would redistribute in this way. But at least as an academic, when we talk about redistribution, we're usually talking about income redistribution specifically. And income redistribution really has two primary forms. One is in the form of taxes, so you can have progressive taxes. This would be a way to redistribute income and the collection side of things, and you can have direct transfers. And this is a big discussion, especially in Europe right now as well, about this idea of a basic income. Should everyone have a certain level of basic income? And that's maybe something we want to talk about. Again, it's up to you as the audience. So one of the questions I want to answer or maybe discuss with you, so I may not have all the answers, but is why do governments engage in redistribution? And I think one of the big arguments is relates to economic productivity. So in sort of advanced or modern capitalism, productivity is really defined in the sense of consumption. And so through redistribution, you can create a greater number of consumers or people who can spend their money and have liquid capital, which is the basis of at least the concept of modern capitalism, let's say. But another very different purpose would be nation state building. And so I don't mean this idea of an ethnic or cultural sense of nation or nationhood, but really the nation state, so the government itself as the leader of this and defender of such a group of people. And through redistribution, you have this experience where the public, if more members of the public feel like, oh, the government gives something to me, then I feel more attached, or I might have more social solidarity. That's also a topic that many of us are interested in, that I would feel more commitment to this nation state. There's also the power resources perspective, which has to do with, to put it quite simply, buying votes. So through redistribution, a case like Venezuela is a sort of perfect example, right? You give certain transfers to certain groups to ensure certain election outcomes, for example. And now what we might want to talk about today is the role of public opinion. So in this ideal concept of democracy, we might like to think that what the public wants, they would get, because the political system is designed to provide this. And so that's something maybe good for discussion here. And so who supports redistribution and why? Hopefully. So the theory on this really is, oh, there's a lot of rational choice kind of theory background to this. Why would anyone support redistribution? Well, if their income would be directly increased from a redistributive policy, you would think they would say yes. I'm materially self-interested in receiving the product of this policy, so to speak. But it's very difficult to measure who would stand to gain. So you have things like this median voter theorem and these other ideas of, so if you're at a certain point in the income distribution, you might gain. But that would assume these policies that do some kind of perfect distribution, where it's perfectly calculated based on certain factors. And the reality of most policies is they don't work this way, right? So it's very difficult for the public themselves to realize, would I benefit from the policies we are discussing now, and also for policymakers or academics to identify who would be gaining from this redistribution. So we also, and I'm a public opinion scholar, but I will raise a lot of skepticism or critical ideas that we should think about when it comes to the study of public opinion. Because you have this concept, which is about a plurality, right, of many, many people, but it's a singular noun, so as if there's one public opinion. And so I would argue, and have argued before, we might even think better about public opinions with an S, as in plural. Again, another reason why it's difficult to understand who supports redistribution. Also, practically speaking, we have to be very careful with these public opinion measures, right? So these are the El SOC, if I say that right. This is this Chilean survey, which is really nice, has really great data. I learned about it recently. And the point is, you see here data from 2019 and 2020. And we could say this is public opinion on the question that social spending should be targeted to the most needy, the most vulnerable population. And Basically, and this is a perfect example because in my experience, all survey data are very much like this when it comes to questions about redistributive policy, social policy. You don't see much change, right? So you measure, you have these margins, what we think this representative sample reflects of public opinion. This is the average, so to speak. And in most cases, so a 3 on the y-axis is neutral. And so people are more positive towards the idea of targeting spending and redistribution, but many, all of the redistribution questions tend to be in this direction. So we'll come back to this point in, at the end of my presentation, but hopefully also in the discussion, what can we really learn by through these surveys when we ask this question over and over again? What are we learning about the public? Is this public opinion? It would even be the more provocative way of asking this question. But anyway, let's be a bit more practical. So all governments engage in redistribution. How do we measure that? So one way is to look at a comparison of the market-based income to the disposable income. So market-based is what one is earns on paper, so to speak, is paid, and disposable income is what one gets directly in their bank account, so to speak, so after taxes and transfers. And if the market-based, and many of us in the room are familiar with this idea of a Gini, so we measure it from 0 to 1 or 0 to 100 is sometimes easier, and a 0 is everybody has the same income, whether that's market-based or disposable, and a 100 is all of the income is with one person. Of course, this doesn't really exist in practice, but we can quantify the distribution or quantify the amount of inequality by using this Gini coefficient. And so, for example, the case of Brazil here that I've just pointed out, so the distance from the line that Brazil is redistribution. Right, so you have on the x-axis the actual market-based income, and then you have this position on the y-axis. How did the market-based income distribution change through redistribution? And what's also, I think, quite interesting about this particular graph is if you can kind of look in a line. I don't know if I have a pointer. No. Or maybe you can look, I do, okay. So you can look in this kind of line, so Sweden, Germany, Deutschland, USA, Chile, they all have almost the same market-based income inequality. But the amount of redistribution is very dramatically different, right? So Sweden, we all know, has a lot of redistribution, and Germany a little bit less, USA much less, and Chile then again much less, but still below the line. There are also interesting cases like China, where we would talk less about redistribution and in the first place just talk about distribution, because historically in this type of society the market incomes are set before, so you don't get a lot of change through taxes and transfers. And this can be another point for discussion. Also, a case like China is interesting because it's so big. Having a billion people really skews the Gini coefficient. So China is actually one of an extremely unequal society. But there's so many people that the Gini doesn't look as unequal as one might expect. So another reason to be cautious with using this Gini coefficient. So also in this talk, it's not just about redistribution, but I want to talk about social security. And so what we mean by social security is things like pensions or unemployment or labor market protection against labor market risks, so insurance in many ways. And social security is interesting because it's not always direct transfers, but governments make laws that say you can save privately. There's a lot of these laws that are set up. Chile is also a case like this where you have private savings and the government, rather than taxing and spending, has set up systems for this or rules about how people need to behave in this way to insure against risks of aging, if you want to call that a risk. It sounds a bit strange, but losing your income in older age. And this particular graph, I think, is interesting because we see GDP per capita. I think most of us in this room are familiar with this concept of gross domestic product. It basically means what is the kind of average income, or how wealthy is a society, we could say, or what's the consumptive power, if you like. And on, that's on the x-axis here, and on the y-axis you have social spending on these typical classic social security policies like health care and pensions. And we see that there isn't this like strong association. There may be some kind of curve, it's unclear, but for example, Chile and Ireland have relatively similar amounts of social spending as a percentage of GDP, but are extremely different in terms of GDP itself, right? So I present this graph because one of the big arguments in economic theory or economic history is that societies that have more money would spend more money on social security, and that's why I would present this Kuznets curve. The Kuznets curve is really, it's basically a theoretical argument, I've just visualized it here, that as societies start out, so you have this starting point where we shift from subsistence farming or something and experience like capitalistic development, and inequality actually increases. And this is a very strong argument that inequality increases at first, and but then as a society becomes much richer, wealthier, then it would become more equal. And I would challenge this argument because of the graph I just showed you, and especially this graph, where we just don't see, we don't see the curve in the actual Gini, whether we're looking at disposable or market income. We don't see that richer societies are more equal. That's basically what we don't see. There may be a very small relationship, but it's not clear. And I think that's something important to keep in mind. Coming to public opinion, what do people think about inequality? Well, again, a three on these measures would be neutral, right? So these are almost all these survey questions, the Chilean survey and the ISSP, the International Social Survey Program, and many of the data we use for this, they tend to have these five category questions. So they're strongly disagree, disagree, neutral, agree, strongly agree. And basically in every country of the world, the population, the public opinion, on average, agrees that there's too much inequality. This is very common. But it doesn't follow a specific pattern related to the inequality itself, for example, or the development of the country. And this is an important point to point out because we have these sort of puzzling findings, again, in the literature. You have this paper, it just came out by Trump, that perceived inequality has no association with the actual inequality. That's basically what I'm showing you in this graph. You can see Chile here, right? So people agree that there's too much inequality, but it's that level of agreement isn't that different from Spain or Germany, right? So there isn't this clear association with actual inequality, which is on the x-axis here. Yeah. And so this is a consistent finding. And also, in previous research that I did, actual inequality has no association with support for redistribution. And we're going to talk about the support for redistribution in a moment. And we also have these other studies. This one from Sands is quite an important one because it looks at experimental evidence that shows that if you actually have exposure to inequality, if you're presented or sort of triggered by or exposed to inequality, that you would become less generous and less willing to share, which would suggest that inequality would actually reduce support for redistribution if we believe these findings. So the two questions I'm going to talk a lot about are from the International Social Survey Program, and I just showed you the one, which is that people believe their society is too unequal. There's too much difference between rich and poor. The other one is the government should do something about it. So the government should redistribute income as a way to resolve this. And this is a bit of a complicated graph, so let's walk through it slowly. So on the x-axis, you have the percentage who agree in many different countries that the income gap is too large, so there's too much inequality. So in all countries, basically, it's more than 70% of the people agree with this. Right? And some of them, it gets close to 100%, that people say, the public opinion is, there's too much inequality in my country. But on the y-axis, so here, is the percentage of those people who say that there's too much inequality that do not support redistribution, basically. They say, well, no, I don't agree the government should do something about it, so to speak. So let's take an easy case, my case, the USA up here. So roughly 80% of the people say there's too much inequality in the USA. But of those 80%, about 35% of them don't think the government should redistribute. And we shouldn't be too normative about public opinion, but these are kind of inconsistent attitudes, right? So if they think there's too much inequality, they should support redistribution. But we don't see that. There's a third layer to this graph, which is the color. So the color of the countries is the correlation. And so correlation is basically this, the Pearson correlation. So you have five categories of each of these measures in the survey. I agree or disagree that there's too much inequality, and I agree or disagree that the government should redistribute. And how much do these associate with? So if I'm neutral on one, I might be neutral on the other, right? So if I support one, I should support the other. And so this correlation is a measure of how closely linked these five categories are within the same respondents to the survey. And what's really interesting, and so also to talk about Chile, is the color yellow is one of the lower correlations. So in a country like Chile, you have a very low association with these. And it's not the only country, of course. And so the opposite case would be like the Netherlands or Finland, where basically the people who say there's too much inequality also say we should redistribute, or the government should redistribute. So essentially what this tells us is people in Chile think inequality is too high, but they don't necessarily support redistribution. So I don't study Chile, I must say. I'm not the expert on Chile. But I frame this as a question. Why don't people in Chile have higher support for redistribution, and how can we test this? And so in the 7 minutes I have left, I will try to quickly go through the results of these findings. So really quick, on the left side, panel A, you see a theoretical model. This is very straightforward, so this is not any kind of rocket science. It's just if you think there's too much inequality, this should be a cause of supporting redistribution, like from an attitude development perspective. What is the cognitive process that happens in people when they answer these survey questions? But as I showed you this last graph, we see that this varies very much by society. So we see very different patterns of association by society. And so our argument, at least in this research, is that there's something like, so in panel B, something like a government heuristic. And heuristic is something that would be a cue when the person responds to the survey that there's something shapes their response, why they don't say they support redistribution. And we think it has something to do with the perception of government, right? So if you think the government is bad or ineffective or maybe corrupt, you would be less likely to say they should do anything from a policy perspective, but in this case, not redistribution. Because one would think it's not going to be an effective policy. At least that would be the logic we develop. And so how can we test this? Well, I've presented these two questions to you from the International Social Survey Program, right? The first question is, there's too much inequality. Inequality is too high in my society. And the other one mentions the government specifically, should the government redistribute to reduce the income differences? And so those are the two questions we want to work with. But we aren't exactly sure what is the heuristic. So what do people think about when they think of the government? And it's probably quite complicated, and it's probably very different. Each person is different in how they respond on a specific survey. And of course, you can do experimental research on this, but I'm more the larger perspective comparativist. So using the data we already have, we do have a question in the ISSP, which is about this corruption in careers, I would say. So the question, in, at least in English, is to get all the way to the top in my country today, you have to be corrupt. So it doesn't mention the government, unfortunately. But it would be an ideal test because we don't have a question in the same survey in the ISSP that mentions government being corrupt or something like that. But we would expect, if this government heuristic theory is true, that people would respond to this question, ah, yes, I think my country is corrupt, and therefore, no, I don't support redistribution. But we have some other maybe better data sources, but from different surveys. So it's not the same people being surveyed, but some of you have maybe heard of the CPI, the Corruption Perceptions Index. And this is a really excellent source of data where they do expert surveys and they do public opinion surveys, and it's basically a measure of how corrupt people think their government is. So this is directly what we want to measure. It's an attitude towards government. But it's, again, it's only at the country level, so we can only use this other data source and try to apply it to the data we're interested in. There's also the IVS, which many of you maybe know, the World Values Survey, or World Values Surveys. There's a integrated value surveys, which includes the World Values Surveys and the European Values Surveys. And these have a question that's specifically about that the government can be trusted or not, and how people agree with that. So these are our ideas about how to sort of test these heuristics, but there are a lot of other reasons, and this is a debate I've even just having a few conversations with some people also here in Chile. This is a huge topic in Europe, obviously, is about immigration. And so it's possible that people would say, I don't support redistribution because I think the money is going to immigrants, basically. So this is something we want to consider in our models. But we also want to consider, again, coming back to economic productivity. So we don't know exactly how people form their attitudes towards government, or many people probably form them differently. And so it's possible that when one thinks of their government, they just think of, well, are we a wealthy country? Like, how is the economic performance of our country? And therefore, based on this, I will form some attitudes about government, or whether I think that they're capable of doing anything effective with policy, like a redistributive policy. Inequality should matter. All the research actually shows that it doesn't too much, which is quite interesting. And also social spending should matter. So we could call this the Sweden effect, maybe. So people might answer this question in Sweden, thinking in mind, well, we already spend so much money on redistribution, the government already does so much social policy and redistributive policy, that I will say no to this particular survey question, because I support it, but it's already happening, so no, we shouldn't have any more redistribution. Thank you very much. This would be the sort of Sweden effect. And it's nice that you mentioned open science and transparency. So we don't know the data generating model here exactly. We have a theory that this government heuristic matters, but when we don't know the data generating model, at least from my perspective, and I'll talk about this in my talk that I'm giving tomorrow, we should think about all the plausible models and run them all and look at the results and compare the results. Because in academia, quick teaser about tomorrow's talk, we often see, like, here's one model. Let me present to you my one regression results and say, oh, this is the truth, so to speak. And in this case, like in so many cases in social science, right, which is very complex, human nature is very complex, we don't know. So it's better to run all the models. I'm almost out of time, but I'm also almost finished. But the effective interest is, what is the effect of the government heuristic? So from a technical perspective, these are like regression models. We're testing the association of the perception of inequality with support for redistribution. And this is like an interaction effect or a moderation effect. Or if you want to be really technical, it's slopes as outcomes. result. But the point is that if I have a more negative perception of government, I'm less likely to agree that there's too much inequality and agree that the government should do redistribution to solve it. So the connection is worse. So this correlation we saw in Chile, which is like 0.4, this would be a way to explain that, at least in these tests. So when we plot all these models, this is a kind of specification curve, and it may look something like this. And so the colored points are these moderation effects. So this is like the effect of our different heuristics on the association of perceptions of inequality and support for redistribution. And so this was the first question here about this corruption in careers and status attainment. So if I to get to the top, I have to be corrupt. It didn't mention government specifically. And it also shows no association that we were testing for. And so this, I think this is telling, because the question doesn't mention government. So in a way, this guides how do we think about what is this government heuristic. Corruption perceptions, here we see the strongest effects. They're a little bit different depending on which variables you include in the model. But all of them are negative, and some of them are quite strong. And the idea is, if the society is more corrupt, I'm less likely to agree the government should redistribute, despite thinking there's too much inequality in my society. And we see a similar effect with this lack of trust in government. That's here. But we also see this effect for economic productivity. So this is not a measure of public opinion at all, right? This is just what's the GDP. But we can see that if a society has a higher GDP, attitudes are more consistent, so to speak. Now, these all have a high association with each other. So richer societies are, on average, less corrupt, and people have more trust in government. So it's very difficult to say which is in play. I'm 1 minute over, so I'm coming to the last slides. And so why don't people in Chile have higher support for government redistribution? Well, I would say, based on at least our results, there's a more negative view of government, more negative than in Sweden, for example, or Germany. But we don't know exactly what the nature of this attitude is, right? So this is just an attempt to explain this. So in redistribution research, like some of those findings I presented, this is kind of a puzzle. And so we're trying to present maybe an answer or better questions of how we could answer this puzzle. And I will go, let's go faster. We should be cautious with this public opinion and surveys because this is the final thing I'll say. The idea of studying public opinion is that it matters, right? So that because the public would have some position, maybe they're going to riot or have a protest or vote in a different way, public opinion should matter. And the types of surveys a lot of us are working with may not measure exactly that, because they are carried out over many months and they ask the same questions on a repeating basis, right? And so you would think of more this polling versus a survey as, well, how are you going to vote in the election tomorrow? Or should Chile have a new constitution and what should be in this constitution, right? But these surveys may not have the right questions for that. And because I'm over time, I won't talk more about that. So thank you so much for your time. We can just do it in the discussion.
Muchas gracias, doctor Bresnau, por su excelente presentación, muy, muy interesante. Voy a hacer dos preguntas. Una es más conceptual, tiene que ver con lo que podríamos denominar el fatalismo del modelo del votante mediano, así le he llamado. Como sabemos, El modelo del votante mediano predice que un aumento en la desigualdad, reflejado en una mayor brecha entre el ingreso mediano y el ingreso promedio, aumenta la demanda por redistribución, pues está en el interés del votante de ingreso mediano reducir esa brecha. Dado que la política es sensible, dice este modelo, a las demandas del votante mediano, esta situación conduciría a un incremento en las políticas redistributivas. Este modelo procede así en dos pasos. Primero, desigualdad y demanda por redistribución están positivamente correlacionadas. Segundo, las preferencias redistributivas agregadas, que estudiamos a través de encuestas de opinión, en un país determinan el nivel real de redistribución. La evidencia que nos ha mostrado tan clara y convincentemente el doctor Breznau en este seminario, creo, cuestiona fuertemente el primero de los dos elementos mencionados. Por las distintas razones que expuso, históricas, institucionales, cognitivas, mayores grados de desigualdad no se traducen directamente en mayor presión ciudadana por la redistribución, ni entre los países, ni al interior de los países. Es decir, no podemos esperar una correlación positiva entre desigualdad y demandas redistributivas. Sin embargo, me parece que el segundo elemento del modelo del votante mediano no es igualmente cuestionado. Es decir, esta idea de que las preferencias redistributivas agregadas en un país determinan su nivel real de redistribución. Y como resultado de este razonamiento, se produce cierto fatalismo. La desigualdad continuará incrementándose a menos que exista una fuerte demanda redistributiva, especialmente de los grupos más directos y negativamente afectados por ella. En un artículo suyo, ¿no?, con Carola Homerich, está citado en la presentación, ustedes concluyen, cito textual, mientras las preferencias no cambien, es probable que la desigualdad siga aumentando. Ustedes en el artículo son explícitos en el supuesto a la base de este razonamiento. Vuelvo a citar. Asumimos que la desigualdad continuará incrementándose a menos que el público comience a apoyar la intervención del gobierno como respuesta a la desigualdad. Este es el supuesto, ¿no?, en el cual hace el análisis. Pero como bien ha mostrado en su presentación, ni el público en general, ni los sectores más desfavorecidos con la desigualdad en particular, demandan a los gobiernos más redistribución o no al menos con la fuerza que esperaríamos. Mi pregunta se centra en las condiciones sociales necesarias para la acción redistributiva del gobierno. Si nos mantenemos fieles al segundo elemento del modelo del votante mediano, es decir, que los ciudadanos deben demandar mayor redistribución a través de la acción del gobierno para alcanzar mayores niveles de igualdad, entonces nuestras herramientas para actuar se reducen principalmente a dos: persuadir y educar a la sociedad. Mi pregunta es, ¿son estas las dos únicas herramientas que tenemos? ¿Existirán otras formas de innovación política y reforma institucional que puedan promover la igualdad y la justicia social sin depender de las preferencias agregadas de los ciudadanos? Al menos no de la forma en que nos obliga a pensar el modelo del votante mediano.
Yeah, so, sí. Great question. Yeah, I should have taken notes on this presentation of the question. So the first skeptical point, so I think I have to take this one. The first skeptical point is maybe we can't measure these preferences so well. And so we actually don't know if that's true. But you say, are these the only options we have? And we means, yeah, who is we in this paradigm? So if you're a policymaker and you have a coalition or you have a regime that supports you, you actually can do, so to speak, what you like. And this is, so some of the big innovations in redistributive policy came at a time where some societies, like Germany, for example, were not so democratic, actually. And some of them were a response to, so they were more about this national solidarity or nation state building. So we have Bismarck in Germany, for example, introducing a lot of redistributive and social security policies as a way to prevent communism or as a way to prevent overthrowing the government. And another really great example is this national health system in the UK. Again, I know more about the European societies. This was very unpopular when it was introduced. So you have this system introduced, and it takes actually many years before the public realizes, oh, I'm benefiting from this policy. So, and today, in the most, let's say, advanced democratic places, it's very difficult to introduce a policy that's somehow redistributive because it requires lots of bureaucratic machinery or technology to implement it and somehow, you know, tax and spend in the right ways. And you have to deal with, like, the free riders or the cheaters or how do we make sure that the people that are most in need are getting the policy. And so I think the fatalism is a theoretical fatalism, but it's also like a real fatalism because the people may support redistribution like they do. I mean, they say our societies are too unequal, and most places they also say, you know, a majority supports redistribution. But when a political party comes in or a regime or something and says, okay, we're going to make a redistributive policy, there's so much uncertainty attached to this that even we as scholars and certainly members of the public, they don't know what is the meaning of this policy. So they can't actually calculate, will I benefit, right? They, even if it seems like, oh, my income is this distance from the median, so I would benefit, you know, 20% from this policy, I think even that calculation may not be accurate because of so many other factors of implementing these policies. Yeah.
Great.
These are the things we should think about, probably. I guess maybe one more thing, though, is and this is why we struggle between public opinion surveys, where we have over 6 months we've been asking this question and we see that people sort of support inequality, and then events of public opinion. So again, this comes down to the definition of what is public opinion. So when the public is suddenly like burning down subway stations and having huge demonstrations or something like that, this is, one might say, a real example of public opinion taking effect. And I think, again, it comes back to the idea there may be a measurement problem here, that in our surveys we may not be measuring. So some of these this experimental research by Trump, Christella Trump, also, if you show people exactly what the policy, who would benefit, and whether they would benefit from it, then they answer the question very easily. Oh, yes, I support that. But no policymaker can even say in advance that the policy is going to work, even in very efficient, effective governments.
Yeah. Gracias. Mi segunda pregunta es más local. My second question es más local, relacionada con el contexto político y social de nuestro país. En Chile llevamos años discutiendo reformas al sistema de pensiones y al sistema de impuestos, ¿no?, con el objetivo de hacerlos más solidarios y progresivos. Sin embargo, nuestro sistema político a la fecha ha sido incapaz de implementar estas reformas. Una interpretación común en Chile es que los altos niveles de adhesión a valores individualistas o meritocráticos dificultarían la implementación de estas reformas. Las personas en Chile tienden a creer que la distribución de recompensas en la sociedad debiera depender más del talento y el esfuerzo individual y menos de la acción redistributiva del Estado. ¿Cuál es su opinión respecto de esta explicación? ¿Podría la actitud menos positiva hacia el Estado o el gobierno que usted sugiere al final de su presentación ser explicada por esta especie de hegemonía cultural de la meritocracia? Me gustaría además saber si su investigación ha abordado el papel de la meritocracia en las demandas redistributivas de la ciudadanía y la formación de políticas de bienestar en otros países.
Yeah, so not directly, because it's unclear what, when we talk about meritocracy, we need instruments for that. So is it, so I don't know if any of you are economists, but here's where I take a strong argument against like the Kuznets curve or, oh, if we just have so X amount of development, then we will have more meritocratic outcomes because the market sets them. And so I also admit I'm a sociologist, so I'm more skeptical of this, but we think that the capitalist market somehow, there is no invisible hand that's distributing rewards in a way that are meritocratic, which goes to your question in the sense that we can't just create meritocracy. It's probably even harder to create than redistributive policy. I think many policy actions have been a way to try to make outcomes more equal, but meritocracy is about the inputs themselves. So in the first place, that people are rewarded for their talent or their, so to speak. And, but if... Now going maybe in favor of economists' arguments, if you really have a strict meritocracy and you distribute incomes based on this, you should have a lot of inequality, I think. Yeah.
Bien, abrimos la sesión para preguntas del público. Tenemos varias manos. Aldo, primero. En la casa.
Muchas gracias. Yo quería volver sobre la pregunta de Mauricio, porque en la heurística de que el gobierno es la variable incidente en la relación, en el modelo que usted desarrolló, me parece que hay dos alternativas a eso para explicar por qué la gente puede reconocer la existencia de desigualdades, ¿no? Pero no estar de acuerdo con las preferencias. Una es la que usted presenta, que es la que el gobierno puede ser corrupto o ineficiente. Pero la otra tiene que ver con que el ascenso social, ¿no?, depende del individuo, que está en el frame en el marco de la pregunta que hizo Mauricio. O sea, no es el gobierno, sino que el responsable, ¿no?, del posicionamiento social es el individuo, y en ese sentido uno puede pensar en meritocracia, puede pensar en individualismo. En las investigaciones que hemos hecho acá respecto de ese tema, justamente vemos que hay un cierto individualismo y una visión muy instrumental de las instituciones sociales, no en el sentido redistributivo, sino que te apoyen en los momentos de shock. Y esa es una alternativa a la corrupción y ineficiencia del gobierno. Y la segunda alternativa es que la idea de redistribución es una idea universalista, ¿no? Y en la política contemporánea, no solo en Chile, sino que en Europa, Estados Unidos, lo que predomina es la política particularista de la identidad. Entonces, redistribución para todos no. Redistribución para mi grupo, ¿no? Que mi grupo sea el favorecido, pero yo no quiero redistribuir para todos. Y ahí tenemos a los indígenas, tenemos a distintos grupos de indígenas, ¿no?, a las mujeres, a los jóvenes, a los que recogen hongos en el bosque y a los que les gusta el ballet. No sé, como múltiples grupos identitarios en las sociedades que solo fundamentalmente quieren una redistribución para sí mismos. Y yo creo que respecto de esos temas hay varios indicadores en el World Value Service, en el ISSP, que pueden testear como estas preguntas alternativas o estas hipótesis alternativas respecto de por qué hay una diferencia entre redistribución y reconocimiento, redistribución y preferencia redistributiva.
Can we take three questions and then?
Sure.
Yes. Is that okay for you?
You're the moderator. Yeah, no problem. I might not remember all, but.
Hi, I want to know. My name is Alexandra. I'm nurse.
Mi nombre es Alexandra.
No soy socióloga. But I want to know why, if you say that is the general opinion,
hay una opinión general aquí, por ejemplo, en términos de la desigualdad, pero no la redistribución. Quiero saber por qué en Chile, en Estados Unidos y en Canadá, en muchos países saben y están de acuerdo en que las políticas públicas, como la salud,
in pensions,
en las pensiones,
like in, to have a house, for
por ejemplo,
example,
en lo que es
they,
tener una
they
casa,
want, and they
quieren
say, you
y dicen
must give me
que
that
tienen
part,
que
public policies.
Darme esas políticas públicas. Entonces, yo creo que la gente no entiende realmente qué es la redistribución. Porque si necesitas
tener
esas políticas, necesitas dinero, necesitas una redistribución. Ningún gobierno, si no tiene esta política de redistribución, no importa de dónde, quiero saber por qué. En Chile,
por ejemplo,
todas las mujeres, yo soy mujer, ¿cierto? Entonces dicen, queremos mejores pensiones.
Y
si está, por ejemplo, en
Las
Condes, en el centro, quieres, ¿verdad?
Y dices
que el gobierno debe darme mejores pensiones, tiene que darme mejor salud, debe darme más seguridad. Entonces, si esas políticas están ahí en el aire, no surgen de la nada, necesitas dinero para eso. Entonces, no sé, no soy enfermera, no soy una socióloga, pero no entiendo cómo. La gente quiere mejores políticas, políticas públicas, y no quieren redistribución. Se contradice. Entonces, quiero saber por qué. Porque en algunos países en Europa, por ejemplo, en Canadá, y sé porque he estado ahí, tienen excelentes políticas públicas. Todo el mundo tiene una buena pensión, todo el mundo tiene buena salud, todo el mundo tiene una buena vivienda.
Entonces, to think about redistribution.
En Latinoamérica, donde tienes la peor desigualdad, entonces ahí también uno piensa, necesitamos políticas públicas. Y no solamente porque vivo en Las Condes, por ejemplo,
vivo en Las Condes, vivo
donde sea. Pero tener una buena pensión, pero esa pensión necesita recursos. Entonces, no entiendo esa contradicción para nada. Gracias.
One last question.
Una última pregunta.
Hola, buenas tardes, doctor. Primero, muchas gracias. Thank you very much for your presentation. I'm going to ask in Spanish.
Voy a hacer la pregunta en español.
No,
don't
Spanish.
Worry. It's going to be in Spanish. Don't worry.
Estaba viendo que había una aparente paradoja de que en situaciones como Chile, por ejemplo, se detecta mucha, la opinión pública detecta mucha desigualdad, pero no quiere redistribución. Y quizá, y una de las explicaciones que usted daba era de que quizá hay un proceso de desconfianza, le llamé así a todo este, de desconfianza respecto al Estado, por distintas razones. Pero yo creo que podría haber otro factor, que es el siguiente. Este análisis pareciera ser un poco estático en el sentido de que es como suma cero. O sea, no podría ser que un país con mucha dinámica económica empezara a proveer a la gente una sensación de bienestar por sus propios logros, que hace que, independientemente que piense que es desigual o no, a él le está yendo mejor. O sea, en el tema es que aquí en este análisis pareciera que hay una situación de riqueza dada y la redistribución mueve la riqueza de un lado para otro, pero no se está considerando el efecto psicológico y práctico que puede tener el crecimiento del Producto Interno Bruto per cápita, aunque la distribución no sea de las mejores. Ese es mi punto que quizás me faltó, digamos. Me gustaría un comentario sobre eso.
Gracias.
Okay, so these questions are all somehow related, but very big questions, so I try to address each one of them. The first one is about immigration or group identity, one might say. And this is a really strong finding, and I would argue this is one of the main problems that policymakers or governments or political parties face when they're trying to implement effective social policies. Because you have people who will say, they will really say, this is research in the US, for example, they will say, yeah, they're a beneficiary of the policy, but they will say we should end the policy for everybody because certain migrant or other groups, racialized groups or so, are benefiting from this. And so I give up, they're willing to give up their right to this policy out of their own sort of self-interest. The next question is in a way related. It's, I think, we should more often talk about taxes when we have these discussions about social policy. So the United States, again, a case I know more about, it's the largest welfare state in the world if you count tax breaks, right? So this is on the side of the very much sort of in the middle class, upper middle class, and these people are a little bit more educated and much more politically active than the sort of working class, and they receive huge tax breaks. You can if you do your taxes well in the U.S., you can pay almost no taxes, basically, especially if you're middle class. And so in that regard, the government is already giving back the money. They're spending a lot of money without spending any money. So it's a much easier way to make these people sort of happy, so to speak. But it's true, but that's why I present this somewhat confusing evidence. You would think you need a certain amount of wealth to have these policies in place. But you don't see exactly this happening where you, right? So the U.S. is a very highly unequal country, also very wealthy. So I think, I think that's the most I can say about it, that if we're going to talk about preferences for redistribution, because if you ask people if they want to pay more taxes, they always say no. That's the point. I think that's the easy way to talk about this question. Yeah. They'd be like, well, maybe we should have redistributive policy. Do you want to pay more taxes for it? No. Right? Even if you're going to benefit from it, the answer is no. Three questions may have been a bit too much, so could you just repeat the key point to remind me? I had thought too much about their...
El punto que yo hacía era de que el tema del crecimiento y del beneficio que puede proporcionarle a la gente no está siendo considerado, y me da la impresión que al definir demanda por redistribución, esa es una demanda secundaria de lo que de la verdadera demanda, que es demanda por bienestar. La demanda por bienestar se puede satisfacer con redistribución, pero también con oportunidades dadas por el crecimiento, con educación que permite dentro de una misma estructura movilidad social. Entonces, yo eché de menos esa dinámica y el análisis me pareció un poco de suma cero. Entonces, me gustaría saber una opinión sobre eso porque me pareció muy interesante en todo caso el análisis. Gracias.
Yeah, thanks, sorry, I it was maybe too many questions, but I think the utility, to use a word economists use, the utility gained from redistribution is much lower than from something like health insurance or something like good education or even insurance against an accident at work. I think the utility is much higher, right? So if your husband or wife might die on the job at work, this is a huge loss compared to maybe you don't have enough money to, if this kind of puts it into context. So I basically agree with your argument that redistribution wouldn't be the most important point, and that's why we try to link the talk to the social welfare state as well here, because in one of my first slides, I think one of the big things is about this building of identity. Again, the problem is identity for whom. This is a big challenge we face here, but by offering things, I think you maybe can't buy national identification as easily with redistribution as you can with policies that are like pensions for women, for example, or a better pension system for women. This would really, if the government were able to produce such a policy, I think it would people would become much more like, oh, the government is doing a great job, and I feel happy to be part of this country. Not, again, we have to distinguish between, so in the Chilean case, it's not about being like ethnically or nationally or born in Chile or so. It's I feel connected to my society where I live in. I feel that the government has some of my best interests in mind. And I think, this is a great point. You can't redistribution, the utility gained from redistribution in this regard is lower than these other policies. Also education, it's one that's, this is always not so popular to talk about, but talking about meritocracy and those kinds of questions, it's clear that the market isn't going to solve the education problem, right? You can't just, if you leave it, if education is purely privatized, we have like what happens in the U.S., basically, where we have public education, but people can take their tax money out of the education system because they'd rather pay on their own, and it creates huge inequality, for example.
Estamos sobre el tiempo ya. No puedo tomar más preguntas. Así es que lo vamos a dejar hasta acá. Podemos conversar acá afuera, me imagino, un par de minutos, ¿verdad? Habían varias manos alzadas para hacerte más preguntas sobre tu investigación y su resultado. Muchas gracias por acompañarnos. Muchas gracias, doctor Breznau. Y nos vemos en una próxima oportunidad.
Gracias. Yeah, I think, thank you.